So now that we have a mobile piece of information, what do we do with it so that we can actually get to the protein that we so desperately want? So this is what translation does for us. Now, translation means that the instructions from the RNA are now being used and converted to the amino acid sequence. So the amino acid sequence can then be changed into a fully functioning protein later. But the main thing that we are concerned with now is how to get the instruction from the RNA to make us an amino acid. Well, as before, none of this works all by itself, and so whereas transcription needed an enzyme, translation requires also a set of tools, a set of other molecules, if you will. And these other molecules are all in the form of some sort of RNA. Now, the RNA that carries the information, that has a fitting name. That's called messenger RNA. Messenger RNA, or mRNA for short, that is what we actually made. So messenger RNA is one of these tools. The second one of them is called tRNA, or transfer RNA. And transfer RNA is literally a transport molecule. It is also made of RNA. So we're still within the language of nucleic acids area. So these things can talk to each other. And it sounds odd when I say that these molecules can talk to each other, but it really turns out that way because there is this business of the genetic code, right? Even though that's not a live language and they're going blah, blah, blah to each other, it is still a way to match up information just as if you had a language. And so the tRNA in that respect is no different. A tRNA, you see, carries something called anticodons. Whereas the codon is what you make from the DNA, the anticodon is something that has the same information content and matches up with it. So it's kind of going back to what the DNA actually looked like, except that it's within the RNA. In addition, because each of these tRNAs carries a specific amino acid, this is what your molecular interpreter looks like. And so you automate this whole process of translating simply by using the right set of codes. And here is where you can find the two important parts. Down here you have the anticodon, and as you can see here, there are three pieces of information. Three pieces of information. Now, this is made up of RNA, so there's another nucleotide, here's another one with some bonding. So this whole structure is all a RNA molecule, but it's not a double helix like DNA. It's just a single one. A single one. Here is the beginning, here's the end, and it just is a convoluted big structure that goes all over the place. And right down here at the foot, so to speak, that's where it has this matching site. We call that an anticodon. And up on the top, there is the amino acid attachment site. The amino acid is attaching right up here, and there is an actual bond, so this thing connects to the amino acid. So it's a carrier molecule. It grabs the amino acid, it moves the amino acid around, and when the right codon is available, then it matches it up and delivers that particular amino acid. So it's a delivery service, and it's pretty neat. So that's transfer RNA. The last one of these helpers, or tools if you will, is the ribosome. The ribosome, those were the small little studs that we had on the surface of the endoplasmic reticulum, the rough endoplasmic reticulum. It is what made it rough. And they're small organelles, and this is where the protein is actually made. They are made up of two subunits, and each of these subunits is made of rRNA, ribosomal RNA. So let's just review. In order to make this work, we are going to need messenger RNA, and that's the info. Obviously very important. The next thing we have is transfer RNA, and that's our interpreter. You can call it an interpreter, or maybe you like to call it a transporter, doesn't really matter. And then we have rRNA, and that's perhaps a way to describe it is vice grips. That's a tool. You put that tool on your desktop, on your workbench, and you can clamp things into it and hold them and let this process continue. So here is the small ribosomal subunit. That's the part at the bottom. On the top is the large ribosomal subunit. And this is where this whole process takes place. That's where you can put the mRNA right there. This is where the tRNAs go. And then, of course, the rest is all rRNA. So that's how you assemble these. And they all can talk to each other. That's why they can hold on to each other and why they can maneuver each other, is because they are all made of RNA and they speak the same language, right? That's what happens here. Now let's take a look at what this all looks like when it's assembled. Just to give you an overview first. So now all the molecules are there. So let's take a quick look. This is, of course, the same ribosome we just saw. So down here at the bottom, you have the small subunit, right? And here on the top, you have the large subunit. In this case, the two places where you can put the transfer RNA are filled. This one already has on it a growing polypeptide. So what happens next is that this polypeptide is going to become attached. And here is your information, the messenger RNA, with the codons and anticodons matched up. So everything is together here. The small subunit and the large subunit of the ribosome act kind of as the vise, hold things together. The information comes in. And then the only thing that has to physically happen is matches are being made. Match, move, match, move, match, move. So slowly but surely, you end up with an elongated polypeptide chain. Translation also has three phases. They're also called initiation, elongation, and termination. In this case, of course, the initiation refers to putting all the pieces together. Elongation means you're growing that polypeptide chain to make it into a long chain of amino acids. And then termination is where you disassemble all of this. So let's take a look. Initiation means assembly. So you start one piece at a time. The small ribosomal subunit binds to the mRNA. Next, the first codon attracts a transfer RNA, and the first amino acid arrives with it. And that's one of the reasons why we always start with the same codon and the same transfer RNA, because this is how they initially interact. This is part of the initiation process. And then, of course, comes the large ribosomal subunit to squeeze in, hold in the messenger RNA and complete initiation. And so this is what you need. You need the messenger RNA. This is one place where you have to be careful that you get the beginning of the sentence right. Think about that for a minute. You cut out the sentence, but then you reverse it. Well, then you don't know which is the end and which is the beginning. So what you do before you even get started with this, you put on the mRNA a cap and a little precursor here, And you put on it also a tail with a little precursor. So these parts, the tail and the cap, those are not part of the gene. They're only giving us the direction. So clearly you start here and you work your way around the molecule like that. Now, once we know that, we can put it all together. So here is, this would be right where the one is, that would be where your cap is. And that's how it fits in. So there's your small ribosomal subunit. And it simply receives this messenger RNA. It sort of lays down in it. And here is your first amino acid. This is therefore the initiator tRNA, the one that starts it all. And down here is the start codon. And the start codon is what first brings everything together, because now with these in place, the large ribosomal subunit can fit in as well. It's a little bit like playing with Legos. You start with the bottom plate, you put in this construct here, you add the first pieces of your tower, and then it will hold the rest of it. You know, just be intuitive about this when you're assembling these pieces. This is not supposed to be hard, it's just a particular sequence in which this has to work. The next step is elongation, and elongation means that these codons are recognized one after the other. Every time there's another one that comes in, another tRNA will match it, and therefore you end up assembling all the tRNAs in a proper order, and the amino acid chain grows in the proper order. Now the peptides bond form, this is one part of the chemistry that's really amazing. As soon as these transfer RNAs are next to each other, click, the peptide bond forms. It's kind of a ratchet mechanism. You put one in, click, and it moves over. You put another one in, click, the bond is formed, and it moves over. And so the amino acid is attached and the sequence will grow. And translocation, that is what I meant when I said they move over. Because once the tRNA is empty, then it doesn't have any purpose anymore, and so it gets moved away in order for it to be recharged. And so here's what that looks like. The process of elongation means first you have codon recognition. So your codon is down here, and this codon attracts this anticodon. So these two match up. When they match up, part two, the peptide bond forms. Click. And this doesn't take long at all. This is literally a chemical process, and it takes very short time for this to happen. Now, as soon as this clicks over, this one is now empty. And when it's empty, it's no longer useful in that position. So it's kicked out. And this one moves over to the next slot. And then, of course, the whole process can start over again. So then you're here, and you just keep going. Now, this literally is very, very fast. You have, it's kind of running a relay, if you will. You always pass on the baton, right? And so you click over, and click over, and the next one comes in, and the next one comes in, and the next one comes in, and so on. Until you get the stop codon. Now, if you have a stop codon, what that means is basically there is no anticodon. So if this is a stop codon, there is no anticodon anymore. So this process just literally dies. It stops. Now, it's a little bit more forceful. The stop codon will actually make this whole structure fall apart. So the stop codons have no tRNAs, and that means this ribosome falls apart. That's termination. Now, the analogy continued from before. Let's say that you have your file downloaded from the website, and it's sitting on your computer, and you have just about admired it for long enough sitting there. Now you actually want to listen to the song. Well, what do you need? You need a mechanism to hear the song. Just staring at it isn't going to do it. So clearly what you need to do is turn up your speakers, right? You're going to have to double click it, and you're going to have to make sure that whatever player you have on your computer or iPad or whatever is actually able to do this. So you need some kind of device, and the loudspeaker and the headphones or whatever it is that you need to take, and you need to decode the information. That's what you need. So decode the information of the music file. Now that the messenger RNA, that is the music file. And because you have the ribosomes and the tRNA and all that stuff, you can actually decode it. And so that would be mission accomplished. And whenever it comes to these kind of things, think about information transfer. If the information is becoming useful to you, then that's like translation. Here is the summary of all of this. Summary of this entire process. Now, the way this is put together, just as a way of encouraging you to study for this, really lends itself well to creating a flowchart. First part is transcription, and I'm not going to go through the details here. Transcription, and then the processing of the RNA so that you know where the beginning is and you know where the end is. This happens in the nucleus. The third thing is you're going to prepare your tRNAs. You're going to need to have the right kind of tools available. So you take the tRNA and an enzyme and a little energy, and you make your tRNA. Fourth, you initiate translation. You put all the pieces together. Five, elongation, where anticodons and codons recognize each other and an amino acid chain is made. And lastly, termination, where the stop codon comes in, and that's the end of the story. So that's your summary. And you can see that it's very linear in terms of how it works. And if you can just figure out how to turn that and actually do it in writing, write down all the steps in this, it's going to be very helpful for you to do.